choose to listen and believe the voice of truth.
That was easy. You know, it's amazing how easy things become when you put them in the hands of the Heavenly Father. And let Him take care of the situation. Let Him take care of the circumstance. There's been a lot of people who have been so stressed out over the last several weeks and months, and now it's time just to release that into the hands of the Father. He is a good God, and He cares about you. He cares for you. And I've got good news for you this morning. He's in a good mood.
Amen.
Right? He's in a good mood.
Amen.
God's in a good mood. He's not looking down from heaven going, oh. That emoji, did you ever see that one where you sort of slap your head with your hand, you know? He's not doing that this morning. He's not going, oh, what did I do? No. He's up in heaven. He's saying, wow, these are my children. These are my children. And it was well worth sending Jesus Christ to do what He did to be able to accomplish what He accomplished. Thank you, Jesus. About 2 weeks ago, I shared with you religion versus Jesus. I had the whiteboard up behind me. I'm not going to bring the whiteboard out here this morning. You'll just have to bear with me. And those watching on video, you'll have to forgive me. I don't have the screen hooked up so you can see it on the video yet. So you just have to look up the scriptures for yourself as I go along. But I want to do a little bit of rehash of some things I talked about previously, and then I'm going to go into something new this morning in the area of religion versus Jesus. I talked 2 weeks ago about Jesus endured the cross for the joy that was set before Him. That's Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. He didn't go to the cross to pay off an angry God. So many of us have been bought in, got this idea of this angry God in heaven, and Jesus came to appease His anger. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that this morning. Number two, I talked about He carried our cross. He carried our cross. How many of you have ever heard the term or somebody say to you, well, that's just my cross that I have to bear? Anybody ever hear that before? There is no cross that you have to bear. Jesus Christ bore the cross so that we don't have to. Matthew chapter 16, 24 through 28. And then thirdly, we talked about this. Righteousness of Christ versus a sinner saved by grace. You've probably heard that phrase before too. Oh, I'm just a sinner saved by grace. There's been songs written by that title that talk about that over and over again. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Well, we were sinners. But now we're the righteousness of Christ. You are not simply a sinner saved by grace. You are truly the righteousness of Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Today I want to go into a new area. I'm going to call it good God, bad God. Good God, bad God. Sort of from that idea of good cop, bad cop. Did you ever see those detective shows on TV where you got the good cop and the bad cop, right? You got the witness that's sitting there in the chair, and they send the bad cop in. What does the bad cop start doing? Starts really rattling the witness's cage. Starts hard nose, that's it, throwing over tables, threatening to throw them up against the wall. And what happens? The good cop comes in. Good cop walks through the door. He says, no, you settle down here. You just go out and let me handle this. So sit the witness down and said, boy, it's a good thing I came in when I did. I don't know what that guy would have done to you, the bad cop. I don't know what would have happened if I wouldn't have come in. But it's a good thing I came in. Now you better start talking or I don't know what he's going to do. Right? He could end up killing you. I don't know what's going to happen because that bad cop, I don't know what he's going to do. And then we see that the witness there, the person being investigated, they start spilling their guts, right? They start sharing everything because they don't want the bad cop to come back in. Well, I'm telling you, there has been this perception of good God, bad God. We see an Old Testament version of God that looks like this, bad God. Right? And then we get the New Testament version, Jesus, who is the good God. Bad God, good God. So God the Father, he's the bad God. Then Jesus shows up on the scene, and he's the good God. Think about it like this. Just imagine for a moment, and this kind of phraseology is used in the Bible at different times about this sort of courtroom setting. And John Calvin really expanded on that. And he really took this idea, because John Calvin was a lawyer. And so he really took some of this idea of God as a judge sitting on the throne in heaven, and then Jesus Christ sitting down there beside us as our advocate, which the Bible says, which we'll talk about in a moment, and intercessor, which the Bible talks about and we'll look at as well. But we get this idea that here's God sitting up there in his wrath. And then we have our advocate sitting next to us. That every time you do something, so let's assume here for a moment that Dave Benjo is the bad God, right? He's the judge. Everybody can imagine that, right? You can see it. You can see it all over his face. You can see the bad God. He's the judge. He's sitting over there. And now the accused comes in. We have the accuser of the brother, Satan, which I'm not sure what he's doing in heaven. But he walks in. We get this idea of this courtroom. He comes walking in, and he accuses you. So you're sitting there next to Jesus, and the accuser comes in. He's accusing you before the king, before the Heavenly Father. He says, Who wants to be the bad guy? Who wants to be a did it wrong? Ryan? Okay. Ryan was using that piece of equipment yesterday, and he swore off a line. I know he didn't, but it... You know, there's always a possibility when that thing snapped and he had to come back over and weld it. You know, who knows? So the accuser is standing before Dave, and he's saying, Ryan said some things that he shouldn't have said and took your name in vain. Now Dave, he immediately, because he's the bad God, right? He's the bad God. So Dave, who's the bad God, he hears the accuser and he goes, oh, I can't stand unrighteousness. I can't stand sin. I can't stand the way these people act. And then we have Jesus. Who's Jesus? Who's Jesus? Is Amanda Jesus today? Okay. Amanda's Jesus. You know? And we'll get some people that go like, how could you say Jesus was a woman? Right? Okay. So Amanda's Jesus, right? So Amanda, Jesus, she cries out and goes, no. Wait, Daddy. We know you're an angry, mean, hateful God, Dave, right? We know you're a mean, hateful, angry, and we know that what Ryan did was totally wrong. He shouldn't have done that. He violated everything. But I'm interceding for him. I'm advocating for him. And so then the Heavenly Father, he goes, all right, I would like to kill him. I would like to punish him for what he did. But because Amanda did what she did, I'm going to not hold it against him. Now that in reality is what most of us as Christians have grown up with. We've grown up with this idea that there's this constant conflict in heaven. God the Father, who's the bad God, did all those terrible things in the Old Testament. Opened up the ground and swallowed up people. Caused the flood to kill hundreds of thousands of people. Who knows how many. He's the bad God. And then Jesus shows up on the scene. He's the good God, and he's constantly interceding, trying to get God, the bad dude, Dave, from pouring forth his wrath upon the sin of Ryan. If it were not for Jesus, Amanda, constantly interceding for Ryan, and for you and for me, we would all be destined and doomed. That's pretty well the image, especially when you listen to some of the teachings of John Calvin, that's pretty well the teachings. That we go to heaven, we enter, we plead our case before the king. We plead our case before the judge. I've even heard that in prayer. That we bombard the gates of heaven with our prayer. We go into the Holy of Holies. You reckon all this terminology is all Old Testament, it's all Old Covenant. We bombard, we go in, we go into the Holy of Holies, we go into His holy presence, but He lives inside of you, so I'm not sure. The Holy of Holies, if you have to go to the throne room in heaven to find the Holy of Holies, then what does He do inside of you? I don't know. But we go into the throne room of heaven and we're pleading our case before the Heavenly Father. All these images of this good God, bad God, cause us this total confusion and misunderstanding of who God the Father truly is. There is no other image of the Father than Jesus. John 14:9, if you've seen me, Jesus, you've seen who?
The Father.
There's no good God, bad God. What Jesus did when He walked the face of this earth, that's who God the Father is. Oh, but Pastor Tim, it can't be. He's the judge. He's the condemner. He's the one that just beats up on people and destroys things, and He's going to obliterate the earth someday and cause it to catch fire, and there's going to be blood all over the place, and there's going to be, whoa. You can't separate Jesus from who the Father is. But yet we've done that over and over again. We've gotten this idea that God the Father is sitting in heaven on His throne, and He's ticked off 3/4 of the time. And the other quarter of time, He's sleeping. That's not who God is. God is love. Our understanding of inferior covenants, which make up the majority of the Old Testament, of inferior covenants does not mean that God is this angry, vindictive God. The fact that Jesus came in the best covenant to describe who the Father is really like doesn't make Jesus the good God and God the Father the bad God. Not at all. We have such a misunderstanding of who God is, of what His love is like, and what He truly does for us. A lot of this started out at the cross when Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And we've been told that when Jesus Christ died on the cross, God the Father had to turn His back and separate Himself. Now, you have to explain this to me. If you believe in the Trinity, right? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Bible. Isn't that what it is? God the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit. If you believe in the Trinity, then I have to ask you this question. How could God separate Himself from His Son if the three are one? When Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I've said this before, just to bring it to your remembrance again. He started to quote Psalm chapter 22. And in that day and age, when somebody started quoting something, it was like reciting the whole passage. And everybody there at the time knew what he was talking about. He wasn't saying, God, why'd you leave me? He wasn't saying that at all. He was simply referring to Psalm chapter 22. Because God never left him. God never forsook him. We get the starting foundation of this good cop, bad cop from that idea that God had to separate because he could not look upon sin. He's so righteous and so holy, he couldn't even recognize sin. He had to separate himself from it. Then we move on. Here's the good God. In 1 John chapter 2, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father. Well, there it is. Jesus Christ the righteous. So he's an advocate. He goes before us as an advocate for the Father. So it must be good cop, bad cop, right? It must be this idea that God the Father sits in heaven and he's waiting to judge. But if we look at this Greek word for advocate, it's parakletos. Para, meaning from or close beside, and kleo, making a call. It's kind of interesting. Look at how parakletos is used elsewhere in the Bible. In John chapter 14, verse 26, it's used to mean the helper, the Holy Spirit. In John chapter 15, verse 26, it's used to mean the helper comes. In John 16, 7, the helper will come, or the comforter. In John chapter 14, 16, the helper. But yet in this one verse in 1 John 2, 1, we use it to mean advocate, which is, we get this idea of a lawyer. But I'm telling you, it's no difference. The usage is no difference in 1 John 2, 1 than it is in any of these other verses. It's not so much as an advocate. It is the helper. It's the one that is there with us to help us. Now, what's the greatest thing that Jesus ever helped us with? A sin problem. Didn't he help you with that? Didn't he care that for you? So when we're looking here at 1 John 2, 1, we immediately see the advocate, because that's the way it's translated, advocate, and that immediately gets you into this mindset of the courtroom, the judge, the advocate, your lawyer sitting beside you. But I'm telling you, this is like a helper. A helper. In Hebrews chapter 7, for it was fitting for us to have such a holy priest, high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners and exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. Because he did this once for all, then he offered up himself. For the law appoints men as a high priest who are weak, but the word of the oath who came after the law of Son made perfect forever appoints the Son once and for all. And that is previous to what I wanted to share. That I wanted to share that towards the end, but ultimately let me change the translation on this for a moment. There we go. The New King James Version, Hebrews 7:25, says this: Therefore, he also is also able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Get that idea, that intercession? So here again, we have Jesus, Amanda, who's sitting in heaven beside you, the evil, terrible person, before the judge, Dave, bad God. And Jesus is interceding for him, for you, for me. But when we look at that intercede, let's take a look and see what that really means. Now, before I even do this, truthfully, how many of you have gotten this image of Jesus being up in heaven praying on your behalf? He's praying on your behalf, right? Right? He's interceding. Really? I mean, that's what I have too, all my life. I've gotten this idea that Jesus is up there and he's interceding because God's ready to just lay it out at any moment. He keeps interceding. That doesn't make any sense, though. If Jesus did what he did on the cross, was it insufficient to take care of everything? Is there more that needs to be done? It's all finished. It's done. So if you do something stupid tomorrow, does Jesus have to intercede on your behalf to keep God from lashing out at you? It doesn't make any sense. If Jesus has to constantly intercede for the stupid stuff that you and I may do, then what he did at the cross did not finish the work. It was only partially completed. Look at this. Here's the intercessor now. Here's Jesus, the intercessor. Let's look and see what it says. Here's the Greek word. I don't even want to begin to try and pronounce it. But again, it's based on these two words, right? Here's the root word, to obtain by hitting the mark. So the word here used for intercession is to hit the mark, to obtain by hitting the mark. So let's go back here again and let's take a look at this. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who draw near to God through him, Jesus, since he always lives to hit the mark for you and me. When did he hit the mark? On the cross. He hit the mark. It was a bullseye. There's the target set up, and whoosh, boom, it hit the mark. And so now Jesus is there, and he constantly is there doing what? He hit the mark. Once and always, he hit that mark. Yeah, Josh.
Because he's always righteous, he's clean.
He is. Jesus Christ did what we couldn't do. The whole Old Testament is to point to Jesus to do something that we could never do. So here this intercession that we think Jesus is up there just pleading with the Father. He's praying on our behalf. He's interceding for us. Look, what he's doing is he's already hit the mark. We need to understand that the work of Jesus Christ is finished. And he lives now in you. So there's nothing more that needs to be done. And you and I, when we finally realize there's nothing more to be done, he has done it all, then everything that you come in contact with also fall into that same line, finished. It's done. When you pray, done. When you speak, done. But we walk in this mindset that Jesus Christ is interceding for us and on our behalf to an angry, hateful God that is ready to strike you down at any moment, so you never know what God's going to do, right? But you've got Jesus living inside of you who finished the work. It is done. When he said on the cross, it is finished, he meant it. It is done. There's nothing else that needs to be fixed. There's nothing else that needs to be done. The only thing that we need to recognize at this point is we've got this thing between our two ears that's called a brain that just doesn't get what Jesus already did. He's no longer interceding in the sense that we think of interceding. It's already done. There's no more intercession to be done, because what Jesus Christ did, he did exactly what this Greek word said. He obtained by hitting the mark. That's exactly what he did. So when you go back here and you read this, therefore he is able to save completely those who draw. Able to save completely those who draw near to God through Jesus, since he always lives to obtain by hitting the mark. Wow, that's amazing. You might say, well, Pastor Tim, there's other scripture verses too that talk about Jesus being an intercessor. What do you think about that? Well, let's take a look. Romans chapter 8. This is awesome. I love it. And if you want some flash drives, there are some flash drives for sale. All right. Romans chapter 8. Okay. Let's start taking a look at Romans chapter 8, starting verse 26. Here we go. Isn't this awesome?
Awesome.
Romans chapter 6, 7, and 8 really go together. All right? It's hard to separate 6, 7, and 8 from each other. In Romans chapter 6, Paul writes and he says that you died with Christ. Christ died, you died. He rose, you rose. Then in chapter 7, he goes on to say about this old man. Anybody remember reading chapter 7? Did you ever hear this terminology? Well, Pastor Tim, I just struggle with that old man. He keeps wanting to keep alive, right? So in chapter 6, in Romans chapter 6, Paul talks about you died and you rose again in newness of life. You're a new creation. In Romans chapter 7, Paul starts talking about this struggle. Not that he's struggling, but that those that try to live in cooperation with the law will continue to struggle. There's this thing going on. If you try and keep the law, if you try and be obedient to the law, if you try and follow that law, you're going to miss it, and you're going to constantly struggle with this old man. It's going to be like back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. Because he already did it in Romans 6. You're a new creation. So in Romans 7, he says, look, if you're still struggling with this law, and he was dealing with a bunch of Romans here, who are a bunch of Jews at Rome who understood this idea of the law. And so they were struggling back and forth, back and forth. That which I want to do, I don't do. That which I do, I don't want to do. And I'm struggling back and forth and back and forth. And then he goes into Romans chapter 8, which is amazing. He starts out in Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He just tells everybody in chapter 7 that there's this struggle, and it's all related to the law. Then he goes into chapter 8 and he says, look, there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And to that we all should go, yes, yes, there's no condemnation. But then we go down a little bit further and we take a look at verse 26. In the same way, the Spirit also helps our weakness. Now, who are we talking about here? Is this Jesus? In the same way, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, right? We're not talking about Jesus, also helps our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself, Jesus, not Jesus, but the Holy Spirit, intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. What do you think that's talking about? Well, we're talking about the Holy Spirit now, not Jesus. We're talking about the Holy Spirit. This is a different Greek word. And so it truly means for the benefit, to come in line with, bending over to intercede, confer behind. So here we're truly talking about that intercession type of thing. But who's doing the interceding? Jesus? The who? The Holy Spirit is doing the interceding with groanings that cannot be uttered. Some might say, and you know, I've always been taught this, that groanings they're talking about are speaking in tongues, or praying in tongues. Right? Which makes sense that it would lend itself to that, but it could be a whole lot of other things in addition to that. With groanings too deep for words, and he searches the hearts, knows what the mind of the Spirit is because he intercedes. Oh, there we see intercede again. Let's see who he's talking about here. Here we know this intercession is done by who? The Holy Spirit. Then we go on. And he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is. Who is he? And he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is. Well, it can't be the Spirit because he knows what the mind of the Spirit is. So it's Jesus. Jesus who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is because he, Jesus, intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Well, let's see. Is it the same Greek word? Oh, guess what? It's the same Greek word, which to obtain by what? Hitting the mark. So there's two Greek words. The one Greek word is used for the Holy Spirit actually doing intercession. The other Greek word is used by Jesus to obtain by hitting the mark. Amazing. We use the same word in our English, but it's not true. In the Greek, it's two totally different words. It's two totally different ideas, two totally different concepts. So here you have the Holy Spirit, which where does the Holy Spirit dwell? Inside of us, which intercedes on your behalf. So who's doing the praying? Well, the Holy Spirit's praying, but whose lips is it using? Yours. You're praying. You're speaking. You're declaring. What's Jesus doing? He's obtaining by hitting the mark. I don't know what this means. Lord, help me. Lord, help us all. What does this mean? Let's keep going. Bear with me, right? Hang in there. Hang in. Well, don't hang in there. That's bad. Stand in there. Stand in there with me. Verse 28, and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. How many of you have heard this verse all by itself talking about all sorts of calamity and bad things happening, right? Okay, put it in its context. This verse needs to be used in context with what? The Holy Spirit interceding through you on your behalf. When that Holy Spirit is working in you, through you, on your behalf, not every bad thing that happens to you is good for you. But those bad things that come to you and try to wreck your life, when you employ the Holy Spirit that's inside of you, guess what God does? He works all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. But in conjunction with this whole idea. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his son, so that he would be the firstborn among how many? Many brethren. Firstborn. That's an idea right there in and of itself. He's the firstborn. I thought Adam was the firstborn. Adam was the first man. Jesus was the last man. Jesus was also the first. Born among many brethren. Who are those additional brethren? We are. You are a brand new creation. Right? You're a brand new creation. You're now what they call a God-man. Not like Adam. You're created in his image. You've got him living inside you, which Adam did not. Oh boy, this is awesome. This is so good. I love it. Okay. firstborn among many brethren, and these whom he predestined, he also called. John Calvin loves to deal with that predestined thing. He also called, and these whom he called, he also justified, and those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? Well, only if it's the good God, right? If it's the bad God, it could be a bad day, because he could be against you, ready to slap you, ready to knock you down, because that's what he does. He's the bad God. But no, it's not true. He's always good. He who did not spare his son, but delivered him over for us all, how did he not also with him freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ is he who died. Yes, rather, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. Well, there's another time. Jesus is interceding for us. So he must be trying to keep this angry, nasty Dave from doing bad things to us. Well, let's look and see what that intercession means. Intercede. Oh, here we go. Look at to obtain by hitting the mark, right here. Yep. To obtain by hitting the mark. So when we look at this intercession again, who also intercedes for us, who sits at the right hand of God, who also obtained by hitting the mark for us. When did he do that? On the cross. Isn't this cool?
Yeah.
I think it's really cool. This is really cool. Because, well, whoo, glory. God's in heaven. He's in a good mood. Jesus isn't up there trying to convince him not to kill me. He's not up there trying to convince God to not hate me. He's not up there trying to convince God not to do these horrible things to me. It's not happening. That intercession, he obtained by hitting the mark. He already did it. It's a done deal. It's sealed. He did it. Who will separate? Then he goes on, the Apostle Paul, and starts asking these questions. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? The answer? No one. Will tribulation separate you? No. Will distress? No. Will persecution? No. Will famine? No. Will nakedness? That could be scary, but still won't separate you. Will peril? No. Will sword? No. And here, I love this. The Apostle Paul throws this in, just that as it is written. For your sake we are being put to death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Another quote from Psalms. Don't you love Psalms? You have to wonder sometimes if the psalmists were schizophrenic. They would, in the same psalm, talk about God being the most amazing God, and then in the next phrase about how he just destroys us. And that's what this psalm does. The Apostle Paul throws it in here, just as a continuation of what will separate us. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Then he goes on and says, look, this is what the Old Testament says, but that was an inferior covenant. It's not there anymore. The same answer to that is no. He's not slaughtering us. He's not putting us to death all day long. It's done. It's finished. It's the same rhetorical response that the Apostle Paul did just earlier. But we take it out now and we go, oh, Pastor Tim, we're put to death every day. Yes, we're put to death. We're just like sheep being led to the slaughter. What? That's exactly what Jesus took. That's what Isaiah 53 said. He was led as a sheep before shearers. That's not for you and me. That was Jesus. He obtained by hitting the mark. That's not for you and me. Now, how many of you think that Romans and Hebrews gets a little confusing sometimes? Right? Anybody? Other than I do. I do, Pastor Tim. Tim. I think they're confusing sometimes. And they are. They can be very confusing. Because you have to understand the language that he's sort of talking about and writing in. We don't talk this way today. We don't write this way today, for the most part. But when the Apostle Paul is using these words, he's not saying that we're being put to death, that we're being considered sheep to the slaughter. He did it, not me. But I've heard Christians quoting this verse. Oh, Pastor Tim, we're all being put to death all day. We're being led as lambs to the slaughter. No. Would you read your Bible for goodness sakes? Yay? All right. But in all these things, see, he's a good God. After all, he's a good God. He's just telling you, relax. But in all these things, we overwhelmingly conquer through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor COVID-19, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is Christ Jesus our Lord. Yay! That is an amazing passage of Scripture. Wow! This is incredible. And it's so powerful and so anointed. I want to read from the very beginning. I'm getting close to the end here, so just hang with me, right? Chill. Relax. Tell them, Dave. Relax.
Relax.
Relax. Okay. This is from the Message translation. Oh, Romans chapter 8. It's so awesome. So now, I want you to relax. Take a deep breath. Go. And trust me, none of that went any further than 2 feet. You're good. Everybody around you is good. Okay. With the arrival of Jesus, the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved. Those who enter into Christ, being here for us, no longer have to live under a continuous, low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. The Spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from the fated lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. God went for the jugular when he sent his son. He didn't deal with the problem as something remote and unimportant. In his son Jesus, he personally took on the human condition. That is so important. He took on the human condition, entered the disordered mess of struggling humanity in order to set it right once and for all. The law code, weakened as it always was by fractured human nature, could never have done that. The law always ended up being used as a band-aid on sin instead of a deep healing of it. And now what the law code asked for, but we couldn't deliver, is accomplished as we, instead of redoubling our own efforts, that's so important, instead of redoubling your own efforts and working even harder, simply embrace what the Spirit is doing in us. Those who think they can do it on their own end up obsessed with measuring their own moral muscle, but never get around to exercising it in real life. Those who trust God's action in them find that God's Spirit is in them, living and breathing God. Obsession with self in these matters is a dead end. Attention to God leads us into the open, into a spacious, free life. Focusing on the self is the opposite of focusing on God. Anyone completely absorbed in self ignores God, ends up thinking more about self than God. That person ignores who God is and what he is doing, and God isn't pleased at being ignored. But if God himself has taken up residence in your life, you can hardly be thinking more of yourself than of him. Anyone, of course, who has not welcomed this invisible, but clearly pleasant, present God, the Spirit of Christ, won't know what we're talking about. But for you who welcome him in whom he dwells, Even though you still experience all the limitations of sin, you yourself experience life on God's terms. It stands to reason, doesn't it, that if the alive and present God who raised Jesus from the dead moves into your life, he'll do the same thing to you that he did in Jesus, bringing you alive to himself? When God lives and breathes in you, and he does, as surely as he did in Jesus, get that, you gotta get that. You are delivered from that dead life. With his spirit living in you, your body will be as alive as Christ's. So don't you see that we don't owe this old do-it-yourself life one red cent? There's nothing in it for us, nothing at all. The best thing to do is to give it a decent burial and get on with your new life. God's spirit beckons. These are things to do, and there are things to do and places to go. The resurrection life you receive from God is not timid, grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a child life. What's next, Papa? God's spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we are. We know who he is, and we know who we are, father and children. And we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. Wow. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. That's why I don't think there's any comparison between the present hard times and the coming good times. The created world itself can hardly wait for what's coming next. Everything in creation, boy, that's in complete contrast to what we keep hearing. The created world itself can hardly wait for what's coming next. It's the revelation of you, the revelation of who you are. Everything in creation is being more or less held back. God reigns in it until both creation and all the creation creatures are ready and can be released at the same moment into the glorious times ahead. Meanwhile, the joyful anticipation deepens. Listen to that. Do you hear that? The joyful anticipation deepens. Boy, that's hard to come by. Oh, it's just terrible out there. To wear a mask, to not wear a mask. That is the question. You know, the great anticipation, it just continues to deepen. All around us, we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pains. But it's not only around us, it's within us. The Spirit of God arousing us within, we're also feeling the birth pains. These sterile and barren bodies of ours are yearning for full deliverance. That is why waiting does not diminish us any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are enlarged in the waiting. We of course, don't see what is enlarging us, but the longer we wait, the longer we become, and the more joyful our expectancy. Meanwhile, the moment we get tired in the waiting, God's Spirit is right alongside us, helping us along. If we don't know how or what to pray, it doesn't matter. He does our praying in and for us, making prayer out of our wordless sighs, our aching groans. He knows us far better than we know ourselves. Knows our pregnant condition and keeps us present before God. That's why we can be sure that every detail in our lives of love for God is worked into something good. God knew what he was doing from the very beginning. He decided from the outset to shape the lives of those who love him along the same lines of the life of his Son. The Son stands first in the line of humanity he restored. We see the original and intended shape of our lives there in him. After God made that decision of what his children should be like, he followed up by calling people by name. After he called them by name, he set them on a solid basis for himself, with himself. And then, after getting them established, he stayed with them to the end, gloriously, gloriously completing what he had begun. So what do you think? With God on our side like this, how can we lose? If God didn't hesitate to put everything on the line for us, embracing our condition, exposing himself to the worst by sending his Son, is there anything else? he wouldn't gladly and freely do for us? And who would dare tangle with God by messing with one of God's chosen? Who would dare even to point a finger? The one who died for us, who was raised to life for us, is in the presence of God at this very moment, sticking up for us. Do you think anyone is going to be able to drive a wedge between us and God's love? There's no way. Not trouble, not hard times, not hatred, not hunger, not homelessness, not bullying threats, not backstabbing, not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. They kill us. You see this? Not even the worst sins listed in Scripture. Then he quotes from Psalms that people quote over themselves. The worst things sins listed in Scripture, they kill us in the cold blood because they hate you. We're sitting ducks. They pick us off one by one. Those are the worst things even listed by Scripture, and it's not for him. None of this phases us because Jesus loves us. I'm absolutely convinced that nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. Isn't that awesome? Romans 8 from the Message translation. Amazing. Simply amazing. In conclusion, there's no good dad, good God, and bad God. Dave is good. Dave is good. Right? He's still good. There is no good God, bad God. Hebrews chapter 9. Therefore, it was necessary for the copies of the things in the heavens to be cleansed with these, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. For Christ did not enter a holy place made with hands, a mere copy of the true one, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God for us. Nor was it that he would offer himself often, as the high priest enters into the holy place year by year with blood that is not his own. Otherwise, he would have needed to suffer once often since the foundation of the world. But now, once at the consummation of the ages, he has been manifested to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And as much as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes the judgment, so Christ also, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time for salvation without a reference to sin. I'm not sure if that's the second time, you know, like in the rapture, the second time in the second coming, or the second time in the third coming, or the first time in the second coming. I think maybe it just truly means a second coming. He will appear a second time for salvation without reference to sin to those who eagerly await him. Isn't that amazing? I want to just look at verse 27. I want to throw something out there just to give you one of these pause moments. Inasmuch as it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes the judgment. Are you dead? Did you die? I hear this verse used all the time for people saying, well, we need to die. You know, everybody has to die, right? You have to get sick and die at some point. Well, here's the verse they use. Inasmuch as it is appointed for men to die once. Didn't you die? Romans 6 says you died with Christ. Some of you are thinking, What do you mean? Think about it. God's a good God. He always was a good God. Always will be a good God. The enemy tries to get you to believe that there's this bad God and good God in heaven, and there's this war going on between Jesus and the Heavenly Father. But there's not. Jesus took care of the human condition once and for all on the cross. And so you and I, as new creations, live to Him. The only time there's that struggle going on is when you start going back into the law and you stop recognizing who you are. You are a new creation. You have Christ Jesus living inside of you. But Pastor Tim, you don't understand. I have things that I do that I really wish I wouldn't do. Well, then recognize the greater one that lives inside of you. And all of that will fall away. There's testimony after testimony of people who, once they recognize the greater one that lives inside of them, stop struggling with issues or situations on your own and recognize the greater one has already taken care of it, and that greater one lives inside of you, it all just falls away. It all just falls away. Isn't it awesome to live in Romans 8? Isn't it amazing to recognize that our one Jesus Christ obtained by hitting the mark? That's the intercession that He did for us. And truly, in our English language today, that's what you would understand it as. He obtained it by hitting the mark. It's not that He's up there begging for God to accept you. God already has, through Jesus Christ. He sees you as that new creation. Jesus Christ, the firstborn among many brethren. We hear over and over again, well, I'm born in Adam. No, you're born in Christ. You're a new creation. All that other stuff has passed away. Father, we thank You. We thank You that we're new creations. We thank You that we live in Romans chapter 6. We live in Romans chapter 8. We don't dwell in Romans chapter 7. We recognize that we are new creations, new creatures, that Jesus Christ is the firstborn, and we're His brothers, we're His sisters. We thank You for it, Father. We thank You for this understanding that You're not looking to punish, to destroy, to tear apart lives. No, through Jesus Christ, You welcome us with open arms, no matter what. He paid for all the past, He paid for all the future, and we don't have to plead with You to accept us. You've already done it. We thank You, Father. We thank You, Father. Now, as we leave this place today, we walk out as new creations, as powerful men and women, empowered from the inside by Christ living in us. And just as the Iron Man has his power source on his chest that glows, we have Jesus that lives in us that glows to the whole world. To see You, we thank You for it, Father. We lay down the cross that we've been told that we have to bear because You bore it. We lay down sickness and weakness and pain that we're told we have to bear because You already bore it. We lay down poverty, deception, and distress, things that the church tells us we have to carry, because You already carried it, Jesus. We don't have to. We lay it down. We thank You for it, Father, that we walk out of here happy, healthy, blessed, prosperous, anointed, and empowered by the Holy Ghost and Jesus Christ that lives in us. We thank You for it, Father. We bless each one. here this morning as they go about their separate ways. We believe for safety and protection upon them. Lord, as they come in contact with any diseases, not just COVID-19, but as they come in contact with any sickness, weakness, or pain, that it just falls to the ground. It dies in our hands. We thank you for it, Father, that we don't live in fear, but we live in great expectation of what you're doing. We thank you for it, Father. We bless the gifts here this morning. We just believe for your Holy Spirit anointing to be upon them, to produce great results. Lord, we believe that many who have been shut down or having difficulty with unemployments or other things, Lord, that they will be blessed superabundantly according to the greater one that lives inside of them, and that is Jesus Christ. Blessed in abundance. We thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming. It's been an awesome, awesome time. Next weekend is Memorial Day weekend. Normally we would take off Memorial Day weekend, but we've had so many days off. We're still going to be here for anybody who happens to show up. So thank you, Jesus. It's a great time to have you here this morning. And
That was easy.
I do apologize for the computer this morning. About a quarter of nine while we're practicing, the power just went out for about a minute. And our computer was fussing the whole time since. It just wouldn't start back up properly. And so apologize for that. We'll get that completed and taken care of in the future. God bless you guys. Having an absolutely amazing day and amazing week. In Jesus' name.
I will listen and believe. I will listen and believe.